ask how you're doing, you smile and say, never better. Lie number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours. So keep your messes and your wounds and your secrets with you behind closed doors. But truth be told, the truth is rarely told. I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken, and when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. There's a sign on the door, says come as you are, but I doubt it. 'Cause if we lived like that was true, every Sunday morning pew would be crowded. But didn't you say that church should look more like a hospital? A safe place for the sick, the sinner and the scarred and the prodigal like me. But truth be told, the truth is rarely told. Oh, am I the only one who says I'm fine? Yeah, I'm fine. Oh, I'm fine. Hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken. Out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. Can I really stand here unashamed, knowing that your love for me won't change? Oh God, if that's really true, then let the truth be told. I say I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, oh, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken. And when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not. And you know it, I don't know why it's so hard to admit it, when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. Yeah, I know, there's no failure, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told.
Good morning. It is the second Sunday after Pentecost. And so you'll notice we'll be green for quite a while here as we make our way through the long season of Pentecost. A few announcements for you. VBS is coming up in a few weeks. I'm not sure if we're looking for volunteers still, but I'd say there's a decent chance we are. So if you're open to that, please contact the people in the bulletin. Lots of rooms moving around. Almost all the teachers are moving in some manner or another, so that's why our hallways are full of stuff and cleaning carpets and all that. So Bible study will not be in the Spanish room, it will be in the sanctuary today. Let's see here. AC not working yet, but we're getting there. We're closer and closer every day. So hopefully soon. And that is all I have for you. So we begin our worship with our opening hymn.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins to God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. And you forgave the iniquity of my sin. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the word, announce the grace of God unto all of you. And in the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be. To God on high, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee, we give thanks to thee for thy great glory. O Lord God, heavenly King, begotten Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sin of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that sittest at the sin of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord, thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high in the glory of God the Father. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Eternal God, your Son Jesus Christ is our true Sabbath rest. Help us to keep each day holy by receiving his word of comfort, that we may find our rest in him, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Deuteronomy chapter 5. Observe the Sabbath day, to keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter or your male servant or your female servant or your ox or your donkey or any of your livestock or the sojourner who is within your gates, that your male servant and your female servant may rest as well as you. You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the land your God brought you out from there with a mighty, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Sing aloud to God, our our strength. Shout for joy to the God of Jacob. Praise the song, sound the tambourine, the sweet lyre with the harp. Blow the trumpet at the new moon, at the full moon on our feast day. For it is a statute for Israel, a just decree of the God of Jacob. He made it a decree of Joseph when he went out over the land of Egypt. I hear a language I had not known. I believe your shoulder of a burden, your hands were freed from the basket. In distress you called and I delivered you. I answered you in the secret place of thunder. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. Hear, O my people, while I admonish you. O Israel, if you would not listen to me, there shall be no strange God among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign God. I am the Lord your God, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning,
is now, and will be forever. Amen. The epistle lesson is from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. What we proclaim is not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our mortal flesh. So death is at work in us, but life in you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the second chapter.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields as they made their way. His disciples began to pluck heads of grain. And the Pharisees were saying to him, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" And he said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he was in need and was hungry, he and those who were with him? How he entered the house of God in the time of Abiathar, the high priest, and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priests to eat, and also gave it to those who were with him. And he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord, even of the Sabbath. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being in substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again, according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
To be his church.
In the name of Jesus, amen. We all have people in our lives that we would like to please. Our bosses, our wives, our husbands, our police officers, our parents, our teachers, our coworkers, our neighbor with a boat, our friend with a large cabin up north on a lake, and maybe even your pastor is somewhere on that list, or maybe not. Most people are pretty easy to please. A compliment, an act of generosity, a listening ear, take their side in an argument, buy them a gift, do something kind for them, etc., etc. Many times we want to please someone in order to get something out of them. Now, it doesn't mean that it's always sinful to do that. In fact, sometimes we try to please someone in order to overcome their own sin. The truth is that we could all be a little bit more generous in our day-to-day lives. But even so, many times we please people because we want them to do something for us, to give us something, to be our friend, or maybe just to have a positive opinion of us. Now, in our list before, we didn't mention someone who should probably be on there: God. We certainly all desire to please God, don't we? There is a difference, however, living a God-pleasing life and living your life trying to please God are two different things. Sometimes we act as if God needs to be pleased in order for him to give us something. You may even do this without thinking. We think that by going to church, by giving our money, by volunteering, or by doing something else that is a good thing, that we will please God, and that he will like us more or reward us. But when our lives don't change for the better, when we still feel the weight of our sin, we sometimes think that God doesn't like us. And so we try to do even more, and at times we even step out of what is truly God-pleasing behavior. This has infected all areas of the church and our world. American cultural Christianity has left many in our culture with the vague belief that if they live what could be called a good life, God will have a positive opinion of them and will let them into heaven. Or we in the church see declining numbers and we believe that we are doing something wrong and believe that God is punishing us. But when our whole life and our whole religion is based around pleasing God, we are in a religion of the law. We start to think that we can fix all our problems by doing something. If only we make better programs, if only our worship is more vibrant, if only we do more good in the community, if only we do this or do that, then God will be pleased with us and will reward us with more people. If only that one person would just get their life together, then God will bless them. But dear Christians, we are not a religion of the law. We are people who listen to both God's law and gospel. The Pharisees and many of the Jews at the time of Jesus followed a religion of the law. They believed that if they followed the law perfectly, the Messiah would come. If they followed the law perfectly, they believed that God would love them and grant them salvation. They even expanded the law so that they had a better chance of keeping it. Our reading for today shows one such expansion of the law, when the disciples are scolded for gleaning some of the harvest to eat, which is not specifically against the third commandment. The Pharisees viewed the Sabbath as just another rule to keep. just another chance for them to please God and earn his favor. And sometimes we do the same. We treat going to church as something that we do in order to please God. If people don't like what we do, well, God must not like it either, so we have to change it. The Sabbath, church, the divine service, whatever you'd like to call it, is not something that we do for God. It is something that God does for us. It is not our chance to serve God or please God and earn his favor or blessing. What happens here is a chance for God to serve us. That's why we call it the divine service. It is God serving us through the ministry of the word that he instituted. In a world of praise bands and mega churches, we put so much pressure on ourselves. Sunday morning becomes an outreach tool, a production. It becomes just one more thing that we have to do in order to please God. Beloved, there is nothing that you can do to please God enough to earn something from him. In the words of Psalm 51, he doesn't want your sacrifices. He doesn't want your works. He doesn't want your money. He doesn't want your service. He wants far more than all those things. He wants you. He wants all of you. He wants your broken and contrite heart. He wants you to understand two things, that you are a sinner and that he loves you. He doesn't love you because of what you do or do not do. He doesn't love you because of how well put together your life is. He doesn't love you because of all the mistakes you haven't made. God loves you because you are his creation. He formed you in your mother's womb. He brought you to the font and he claimed you as his own dearly loved child. God's love for you is shown in many ways, but the Lord of the Sabbath's love for you is shown, is expressed most clearly in this world through the divine service. The divine service is God's turn to care for you. In a busy world, it is your time to rest and have your sins forgiven, hear his word proclaimed, and receive his body and blood. God's work isn't wrapped up in our emotions. His love for you and his work for you is just as sure whether you leave here feeling forgiven or not. Whether you cry during a hymn, feel challenged by a sermon or anything else, I promise you that God has done his work on you today. So rest in his word. Rest in his Sabbath. It was made for you. It is God's gift to you, so receive it gladly and often. Your money, your time, serving your neighbor and volunteering won't make God love you any more or less. But all of those things support the ministry of the word. They help bring God's Sabbath to people. They pay for things like a place to park your car, air conditioning on a hot summer day, heat in the winter, and your works help bring people to our church and to the knowledge of Christ through our school, our care ministries, evangelism events, and many other things that our church does. But in all things that we do as a church, we must remember that all we do must be centered around the Sabbath, around word and sacrament. It all must flow to or from the Lord's Sabbath. Dear Christians, you have a God who is difficult to please. He is satisfied with nothing less than perfection, and you and I are far from that. The Jews were so wrapped up in trying to please God that they crucified him on a cross. So stop trying to please God, because he has already been pleased, as he himself says at the baptism of Jesus. Jesus did everything for you. He is the Lord of the Sabbath. He offers you everything. So rest in Him. And when the world has overwhelmed you, when you feel the weight of your sin bearing down on you, return to the Lord of the Sabbath. Receive the forgiveness of sins through His word and sacrament, and do not stray far from it. God doesn't need you to come to church. You need you to come to church. Your spouse, your children, your neighbors, your friends, your coworkers, your fellow congregation members, they all need you to come to church and receive the sacrament. This anxious and weary world needs rest. Rest that will only come from the Lord of the Sabbath. And you are His witnesses in the world. So come to church and you will find rest. You will receive a foretaste of the eternal rest, the eternal Sabbath that is to come. One day Christ will return, and all the things of this world that drag us down, that weary us, that make us feel tired, that make us feel as if God doesn't love us, will be taken away. On that day, God will call you up out of your grave, out of your momentary rest, and will bring you into an eternal rest with Him and all those who have fallen asleep in Christ in the new heavens and the new earth. In the name of Jesus, amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We stand.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me.
In addition to those listed in our bulletin, we also pray for the family of Helen Harmon, 99. She died on Wednesday. Her graveside service will take place on Tuesday. Please stand for prayer. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the faithful gathered here, that God would shine upon us and destroy the darkness of our sin that our sin has caused in our lives, and thereby help us to shine the light of his grace and truth. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the church gathered and sanctified in God's truth, for Matthew, our synod president, our district president, John, that they would be guided and directed in their tasks, and for all vacant congregations, that God would send laborers into his harvest and sustain those whom he has sent. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For awareness of God's mercies that are new each day, that we may show forth grateful and generous hearts in the church and the world. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For good weather, that we and all people may be well supplied, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all public servants, especially Joseph, our president, Tony, our governor, that they would fulfill their offices with wisdom and compassion, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are afflicted in body or mind, especially those we've named, as well as all who suffer in our midst, that the Lord would be their strength and their song. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy
for all who commune this day, that they would receive our Lord's body and blood in repentance and faith for the forgiveness of sins and in the unity of the true confession. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up unto the Lord. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is meet and right so to do. It is truly meet, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. this do in remembrance of me. In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Run ever to his love.
Give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Let us pray. O God, the Father, the fountain and source of all goodness, who in loving kindness sent your only begotten Son into the flesh, we thank you that for his sake you've given us pardon and peace in this sacrament. And we ask you not to forsake your children, but always to rule our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that we may be enabled constantly to serve you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.